Thick, thin, wispy, low, high, colorful clouds, wet clouds, mosquito clouds, and those dreadful never-ending gray blankets. As an astrophotographer, clouds are usually my worst enemy. But then, there are also these clouds. And they are so cool, beautiful, and rare that I can't get enough of them. Hi, my name is Tim. I'm an astrophotographer based in Sweden, and you're watching Cosmic Captures. In this video, I'll explain what makes these icy clouds so unique, how they form, where you can see them, and how to take great photos of them. Enter Noctilucent clouds. What you see behind me are Noctilucent clouds, also called NLCs. They are the highest and coldest clouds in our atmosphere. The word Noctilucent means night shining, and it's a fitting name for these shimmering clouds of the twilight sky. They are made up of tiny ice crystals that form in the mesosphere, about 85 kilometers above Earth. For these clouds to form, the conditions need to be just right. Think of it as a cosmic recipe. We need extremely cold temperatures around minus 120 degrees Celsius, the presence of water vapor and tiny dust particles. Mix it all together and you'll get these beautiful glowing clouds. They can be observed in higher latitude regions during the summer months, when the mesosphere has the coldest temperatures. In the northern hemisphere, they are typically seen from mid-May to mid-August. And in the southern hemisphere, the best time to observe them is from mid-November to mid-February. During the summer, at high latitudes, the sun only dips a few degrees below the horizon. And the extreme altitude of Noctilucent clouds allows them to remain illuminated by the sun. The tiny ice crystals within these clouds are so small that they scatter sunlight, which gives them their characteristic shimmering and glowing appearance in the twilight sky. They often appear as thin, wispy clouds with intricate patterns that change and move over time. One of the coolest features of Noctilucent clouds is that they look like flowing water with wave-like structures, as if you would watch waves, ripples, and turbulences from beneath the surface. As I mentioned early in the video, we need tiny dust particles in the mesosphere because they act as starting points for ice crystal growth in Noctilucent clouds. The thing is that we can only speculate where these particles come from. Scientists believe that many of them are extraterrestrial material that ends up in the mesosphere when meteors burn up. Another theory suggests that some of those dust particles come from volcanoes. One of the first recorded observations of Noctilucent clouds happened shortly after the eruption of supervolcano Krakatoa in 1883. And there's also increasing evidence that we humans might contribute to the formation of Noctilucent clouds by increasing the amount of greenhouse gases in the upper atmosphere. In my opinion, the fact that there are still many unknowns related to Noctilucent clouds makes observing and photographing them even more magical. Another thing that I love about Noctilucent clouds is that you don't need advanced astrophotography gear to capture their beauty. In fact, any DSLR or mirrorless camera with a somewhat fast lens will work. And if you're lucky enough to experience a bright display of Noctilucent clouds, you can even take fantastic photos with a phone. Many people recommend fast prime lenses for Noctilucent cloud photography, But my absolutely favorite lens for capturing these shimmering clouds is the Tamron 35 to 150 millimeter f2 to 2.8. It's quite fast, and being a zoom lens, it offers great flexibility to capture wider views or zoom in on interesting cloud details. Since noctilucent clouds usually appear close to the horizon, ultra-wide angle lenses may not work effectively because the clouds will only cover a small area in the image. In such cases, normal lenses are usually better. And if you want to capture intricate details in the clouds, a telephoto lens is ideal. There are occasions, though, when noctilucent clouds can cover significant portions of the sky. And in those situations, even an ultra-wide-angle lens can work effectively. A good thing is that your lens doesn't need to be super fast either. I took most photos with an aperture of f2.8. And on occasion, I even had to stop down the lens a bit. What else do you need? I think you want to use your camera on a tripod. And I also recommend a remote shutter release, which will help you to avoid blur from camera shake. But alternatively, you can also set your camera's shutter delay. When setting up your camera, start with an ISO of around 400 and open the aperture of your lens as wide as possible. A good starting exposure time is around 1 second. But keep in mind that the brightness of the sky and the noctilucent clouds can vary, so be prepared to experiment with these settings to achieve the right exposure. As for white balance, I normally use the standard daylight setting, and I always shoot in RAW format because that will give me the chance to fine-tune the settings when I edit the image. If you're more zoomed in on cloud details, it can sometimes be tricky to find the right focus. In those instances, I usually focus on a high contrast area in the far distance, like a tree line, lock the focus, and recenter the camera to the details that I want to capture. If you don't have a dedicated camera, don't worry, because you can use your phone instead. Noctilucent clouds can be bright enough to capture them even handheld. When I tested my phone, I was very surprised on how well those photos came out. Modern phones are a marvel of technology, and there's probably a ton of internal processing going on. But there's no denying that they are becoming more and more capable. So don't let gear hold you back. Use your phone and take amazing images of noctilucent clouds. While I think that still images of noctilucent clouds can look fantastic, for me as a filmmaker, they really come to life when I shoot time lapses. And if you want to learn more about how to do this kind of time lapses, please let me know in the comments below. Another thing with noctilucent clouds is that they're super unpredictable. I was just about to pack up all my gear, go home and get some sleep, when I noticed there's a bright spot over the city of Malmö just behind me. And at first I thought, oh, these are normal clouds that are illuminated from below from the city lights. But no, those are noctilucent clouds as well. Yeah, what a show that is. The cloud over the city is so bright, it almost looks fake. What I also want to do is to take a few panorama shots with those clouds over the city. And I will do that with both the Sony camera and my iPhone. While twilight summer nights might not be ideal for most types of astrophotography, there's beauty in the sky if you care to look for it. So the next time you find yourself under a twilight sky, take a moment to look up and see if you can spot these stunning glowing clouds. And if you want to explore what other types of astrophotography you can do in twilight conditions, watch this video. If you've enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up or subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. And it would be even better if you shared your experiences with Noctilucent clouds in the comments below. Thank you so much for watching. I wish you clear skies and I'll see you in the next video.